So, I'll give you an example. Because I'm going to speak at the men's thing tomorrow, and I know you guys will love this, I promise you. The stuff we've seen just in the last month has been unbelievable. But I teach in our men's fraternity and at Grace at our church and in Atlanta, and we did a big series, and I know some of you have listened to it on Hearing from God. And so we're working through that series, talking about, can we hear from God? What does it look like? How is it biblical? That sort of thing. And about the third week, this guy walks up to me after, we meet at 6 a.m. on Tuesday mornings. That was not my plan, believe me. But this guy walks up to me and he says, he's about 60 years old, he says to me, I just want you to know that I don't believe anything you say and I don't believe in God. I love those kind of people, don't you? I mean, don't try and scare my feelings, dude. Just lay it out there. And so he said, I don't believe a thing you say and I don't believe in God. And I said, well, I do believe in God and I do believe he speaks and I don't want to be here at 6. Why are you here? And he goes, well, he said a friend of mine invited me. I really love the guy. He's a coworker and I didn't want to offend him, so I came this morning, but I just didn't want to go before I told you that. I said, okay, thanks. Appreciate that. Now, what do you say to a guy like that? That's pretty strong, right? So I said, well, do you want to hear God speak right now? And he said, I don't think you heard what I just said to you. And I said, I heard what you said. You don't believe in him, but actually it doesn't work based on that. What you think tends to be sort of omnipotent and omniscient and all this kind of thing. So he's not really limited to what your view is. So I said, would you like to hear him right now? He'll talk to you. And the guy said, okay, all right. I want to hear him speak right now. So I get our men's ministry pastor, who's a young guy, and I said, come with me, I want you to watch this. Because this is how you need to lead men. Watch this, come with me. So Brian, his name is Brian, comes with me. We go into this prayer room, and the guy sits down across from me, and Brian's next to me. And I said to the guy, this is all I'm going to do. I'm going to ask the Lord to speak to you, and then I'm not going to say another word. Okay? And he's like, all right. And so we're just staring at each other. And I said, Lord, Jim here thinks that you don't speak. That's what he believes about you. I think that's wrong. Would you just show him the truth about yourself on whether or not you still speak? Thank you, Lord. I don't know what else to say, actually. So we're looking at each other. And this is Brian I'm trying to disciple. He's wondering, what is this discipleship? This is embarrassing, actually, is all it is. And so I'm looking at the guy, and the guy goes, what am I supposed to do? And I said, just tell me what went right through your mind when I asked God to speak to you. That's all. He kind of speaks to the old mind. It's not super magical. And he goes, well, all right, I see a door. A door, oh, I look at Brian, Brian's like, the door, Here we go. And I said, okay, so you're thinking about a door. What about the door? And he said, well, I'd like to walk through it. I'd like to go through that door. And I said, go through it. And he said, for some reason, I can't. I just feel like I can't. I don't know what it is. And I said, okay, well, Lord, why can't you walk through that door that you're showing him? See, I believe what's happening. He doesn't. But that's why we're there. We're bearing witness to what God is trying to speak into this guy's life, not to condemn him. We're just trying to say, hey, why have you been thinking about a door? Let's ask God. And so I said, Lord, why can't you walk through that door? And the guy bows his head. It's so interesting to watch as they get closer to God, the one they don't believe. And he bows his head and he said, what? He just like to himself, why can't I walk through this door? And he looks at me and he says, something has hold of my feet. And now he's scared. And I said, that's okay. All right, Lord, who has hold of his feet? Well, I know who has hold of his feet so he can't walk through the door. Satan, I know that. Does he believe in Satan? He's going to, in just a minute. Not yet. So I pray that, who's holding his feet? And starts to shake. And he looks up at me and goes, I think it's Satan. And I said, okay. Yeah, I said, we would probably agree with that. I said, do you know why he has hold of you like that? He said, no, but he's terrified to know. But you know what? He knew. He knew exactly why. And that's why you can't believe in God. Because of guilt. and shame. And said, but I don't know what it is. And I'm not going to give him a lecture on guilt and shame because he's dying in it. He doesn't need to hear that again.
Right.
And he's a super successful business guy I know from the community. So anyway, so I said, Lord, how is Satan holding his feet? And he got down on his knees on the floor and put his head on the floor and burst into tears. And so I got on one side and Brian got on the other. And I laid down, I laid my head next to him. He's sobbing and I said, what is it? And he said, we killed two babies. That's what he said. So early in his career, he and his wife had two abortions to keep their career moving. 27 years ago. See, here's the thing. Time doesn't take shame and guilt away. It doesn't. Only God can do that. I don't care how long you wait, you'll deal with it sooner or later. So he said, I killed two babies, and he's weeping. And so I said, go, let it go. Confess, go. Confession is just telling God what he's already telling you. That's all it is. That's all it is. And he said, Lord, I've been holding this for 27 years. It's killing me. It's killing my marriage. And I knew it was wrong at the time, and I just didn't want to believe it. So I don't want to believe in you, but it's wrong, and I know it, and I don't want to feel this way anymore. Like that. That's what he's doing. Beautiful confession. And then I said this to him, and this is really important. I don't know if how you think about prayer. I said, ask the Lord to show you forgiveness. Show it to you. Because I can explain forgiveness to you. I mean, you can have an intellectual conversation about what forgiveness is. But what if you saw it? What if you saw God forgive you? Wouldn't that be more powerful? We do this all the time with men. And so he said, Lord, just let me see forgiveness. And he sees the door open. And Jesus is standing there holding both babies in his arms. And says to him, it's okay, I got it. They're fine. It's okay, I forgive you. Then he reaches out his hand and says to the man, walk through the door with me. And the guy came to Christ right there.
Yeah!
And he gets, this is his testimony. Our pastor says, do you have anything to say? And he said, yes. He said, I believed that God doesn't speak. He does. That was his whole testimony. Can you pray with people like that? Yes. If we believe it. That's the problem. We don't believe it. But this is what prayer does. And if you confess one to another, God heals them and restores them. You should hear this guy give his testimony. It's unbelievable. 27 years of guilt and shame, now he uses as a weapon for the kingdom of God. With great power. The very knife that killed him, he now wields to defeat the enemy in other men's lives.
Claim God doesn't exist, or they don't believe in God. Not because God isn't real, but because something has happened in their life that has caused so much pain, and the enemy has had such a heyday, piling on the guilt and the shame, that if there is a God, he can't be real. I share a little story yesterday with a lady from Alaska that I've been working with and her daughter. You guys need to know that when the truth comes out, God's truth trumps lies.
Yes. Right.
When she was able to understand that everything that she had been experiencing and all the things, all the pain and the hurt, wasn't from God, and it wasn't God who created an arch enemy of her, that he really does love her, things started shifting. Because God's truth trumps the enemy's lies. And nothing is more amazing than getting to experience and see the forgiveness of God.
Yeah.
So I want you to take out your next weapon of mass destruction card. And on this card, you're going to write, forgive. There should be two left that are unwritten on. Pick one. And you're going to write, forgive. Now, I want you to know that unless you are willing to, at your very basis, believe God, forgiveness won't happen.
Right.
It will bring healing.
Right.
Jeremy mentioned about being stuck in this rut of confessing. Confessing and confessing and confessing and confessing for the sake of confessing keeps a wound open and bleeding and gory and gashed and unhealed. Jesus asks us to confess so that we can be healed. Those are his words. Confess one to another so that you can be healed. With that comes forgiveness. Forgiveness is what brings freedom. So if you look back in the addendums of your notebook, there is a section that is titled Taking Back Territory, Learning to Forgive. And you're going to notice it starts with confession, because you cannot forgive without confession, and you cannot confess unless it's followed up with forgiveness. They go hand in hand. So this is something that you guys, I want you to take home, and I want you to be doing with you and the Lord, or if you need someone to walk through with you, like Jerry mentioned with the confession part, find someone that you know is going to walk with you, giving you godly counsel, godly wisdom, and help you walk through this. So this section is something for you to do. You got homework. Yay. But forgiveness is what actually helps us take back the territory. So here, we've recognized the territory. We're going to believe God. We're going to be speaking what our true territory is, what we're wanting. We're going to be confessing so that we can now take our territory back. So to take our territory back, I have a lady that described it this way. She goes, that's like the F word. Forgive? We have to do that. So the first thing we have to do when we look at forgiveness is we have to assess the wound. We have to look at the wound. A lot of times we go, well, that was in the past, that was then, it's past, it's done. I don't want to go back there. We have to look again at what have we put, what gash have we tried to band-aid up with the bandage that's still seeping. We have to count the cost of the loss. You guys, it cost you something. Whether it be it cost you your innocence, whether it be it cost you childhood, whether it be it cost us something. We have to own the burden. This doesn't mean that I've got my pain right here and I'm just gonna, these are mine, I'm owning them now. So they're not yours, you can't have them, they're mine. I'm just going to keep them. No, what this means is, oh, I'm going to recognize I have a hurt spot right here. Now I can release that. I recognize I have a hurt spot right here. Now I can let the Lord have that. So this isn't owning to keep. This is owning to release. You guys have to take the time to mourn. There's been a loss. God didn't give us our tear ducts just for fun to watch us cry when we cut onions. He gave it to us because our tears are cleansing. There is cleansing that happens when the Holy Spirit moves, when Jesus comes in and he is making his home look pretty because we're his home.
Amen.
There's tears that can happen. We have two teenagers that have been going through growing pains. Growing pains? They're hurt. But they make you a little taller. They make you a little stronger. And you start growing. You find yourself growing. But allow yourself the time to mourn for the things that were lost. But you don't get to stay there. You can if you want, but then you would not be even at your basis of believing God. I want to encourage you to not stay there. Don't stay in a place of mourning. Don't stay in a place of grieving. Don't stay in a place of assessing the wound and counting the cost. Instead, now step forward into choosing life. Now you can step forward into choosing the healing. Now you get all the benefits of choosing to believe, speak, walk, and forgive. Deuteronomy 30:19 says, "This day I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing." And by the way, he doesn't end the verse that way. He gives you the answer. This is not a multiple choice. I hope you picked the right one. Deuteronomy 30, verse 19. He says, "I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing." By the way, choose life. Choose life. This is not only going to free you, this is going to free your descendants. Going both directions in every way, it can blow your mind. God does God math. His math doesn't make sense to us. Five loaves and two fish fed how many people? 5,000 men, not including the women and the children. And what did they collect afterwards? Leftovers. God math doesn't make sense. So when you come to this place of deciding, you know what, I'm going to take God for his word, and I'm going to believe him, and I'm going to speak in accordance with his truth, and I'm going to choose to confess and forgive and move forward, his healing doesn't just stop with you. He does God math and blows it out of the water.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
So the first thing is, you can't hold on to it. You can't hold on to this. See, unforgiveness, it's like slapping a cactus because it poked you. It's not going to do you any good. And the cactus isn't the one that's hurting. You are. Unforgiveness is like taking poison and waiting for the other person to die. 1 Corinthians 7:10 says, "Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves absolutely no regret." No regret. Zilch. None. In the words of VeggieTales, noodle. None. There's no regret. None. But worldly sorrow, the depression and the bitterness and the anger and the rage, that brings death. Guys, what is anger a cover for? Pain. Anger always will breed bitterness. Bitterness finds it impossible to speak kindly to family member and friends. Bitterness uses words to hurt others. It communicates hostility and suspicion. It disrespects others, and it's very ungrateful. It rehearses the past over and over and over. It twists the motives and the intentions of others who are trying to help. Someone reaches out to help, and, "Oh, I've seen that before, what's really your motive?" It resists change to help. And it's focused on the self to the exclusion of others. And it's indifferent to the pain that others are caused by you. So, the Lord brought this to us this morning. It's a fun little example. You guys know what this is?
Angry Birds.
This was before Sugar Crush, I think. Maybe it was a tandem. Angry Birds. The whole mission of an Angry Bird is what?
Destroy stuff.
Why?
Because they're angry.
What are we angry about?
Who knows?
The piggies. We have a little king pig who has stolen something from this Angry Bird.
Oh, come on.
That sounds familiar.
This little king piggy has stolen the eggs, the prized possession of this Angry Bird. So, what does this Angry Bird do? This Angry Bird will go through anything, including concrete, because I've done it. They will go through anything, and they will bash at it until it gets through. By the way, I love it's the red one, because that's the first level of Angry Bird, is the red. And they're big, and they kind of... Okay? But what happens every time that you don't pass that level? What happens to the bird? He dies.
Ouch.
What happens? What's his goal? Not just to get his eggs, but what's his goal with the pig? Kill the pig. And then you go on to the next level. I know it's not pink, but I didn't have any of them. Stella. Same goal, different color. The goal was still, I'm going to get what's mine. Kill the king pig. Here's the thing, is that even when you win a level, there's another level. The level is now amped up. We now have more things to get through. We now have more barriers to get through. We now have more king pigs to kill. You guys, the enemy is this teeny little king pig. And he has stolen your worth. We're going to pretend these are eggs now. He's stolen your worth. He's stolen your innocence. He's stolen being loved. He's stolen being belonged to. He's stolen maybe something physical, or your parents, or your identity. And we get so angry, and the enemy twists it so much, that we start forgetting what Ephesians says, when our battle's not against flesh and blood, and we start going after everything that we think we deserve and that is ours, and we start breaking down to kill relationships, other people, everything around us. We're fighting the wrong battle. Now we're fighting flesh and blood, and we're on the wrong side. And everything and everyone is a casualty.
Yeah.
Ouch.
But I want what's mine. We have to stop being the angry birds. Because you guys, every time you go a little farther, which one's this? This is the iceberg. Icebergs aren't really known to be cuddly. They're a little chilly. So we amp it up a level. Now we're just icy.
Flight, fight, or freeze.
What's this one? He's a bomb bird. He will explode anything and everything around him. So you better perfectly place him where you want him so that you can have the most amount of destruction to get what you want. It's God. You guys, we have a choice to stop being angry. We have a choice to stop being bitter. And the only way to stop being an angry bird is to go through into the forgiveness step.
Yeah.
Hurting people will only hurt people.
Yeah.
Hurting people will only hurt people. And we will find ourselves figuring out how we can get to what we perceive to be the king pig, which is those around us. In reality, you guys, it's the enemy. And we start perfectly placing our bombs to get what we feel we need met. 1 Corinthians 7:10, we're going to read it again. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. It doesn't leave you broken and wounded with shrapnel all around you.
Right.
Worldly sorrow brings the death. So we have to get rid of the poison. There's a philosopher, and my son seems to really enjoy his movies. His name's Yoda. He says, fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate, and hate leads to suffering. It will only produce suffering. There's a quote by Frederick Buchner that says, of the seven deadly sins, anger is possibly the most fun. Y'all, in there. It can be very fun for the moment until you look around and recognize, what have I destroyed? To lick your wounds, to snap your lips over grievances long past, to roll over your tongue the prospect of bitter confrontation still to come, and to savor to the last toothsome morsel both the pain you are given and the pain you will give back. In many ways, it's a feast fit for a king. The chief drawback is that what you are wolfing down is yourself. The skeleton at the feast is you. We have to get rid of the poison. Unforgiveness is a poison.
Yeah.
It affects the way you think, it affects the way you believe, it affects the way that you think, it affects your actions, it affects everything you do. And if 87 to 98% of our physical, emotional, and mental problems are due to our thought life, what are we thinking?
Yeah.
What are we drinking on? Ephesians 4, 31 through 32 says, banish bitterness, banish rage, banish anger, banish the shouting and the slander and any and all malicious thoughts. These are poison. Instead, be kind and compassionate. Graciously forgive one another, just as God has forgiven you through the anointed, our liberating King.
Amen.
Forgiveness doesn't happen by chance. It doesn't happen, well, I'm going to confess, and now I'm going to wake up tomorrow feeling forgiven. That doesn't happen. Faith is an intentional choice. Faith is an intentional step that forgiveness intersects with.
Yeah.
Forgiveness is a faith step. True forgiveness is supernatural. It is not natural. And it's something that we cannot do without help from above.
Amen.
We cannot do it on our own. I've tried. It doesn't work. We need Holy Spirit empowerment. It takes faith to forgive. Jesus gave instruction about forgiveness to his disciples, and I must say, I think this is actually rather comical. I love it that Jesus used humor in the Bible. Luke 17:3-5. Jesus is saying, pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him, and if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you 7 times in a day and turns to you 7 times saying, I repent, you must forgive him. And the apostles were like, yay, okay. No, that wasn't their immediate response. It was like, oh, Jesus, increase our faith. To what? To who? How many times will I forgive? Well, I think I can, oh, you mean infinitely? Oh, okay, Jesus, increase our faith. So often, we can categorize what forgiveness is and what forgiveness is not according to our little teachers. And so I want to make really clear what forgiveness is not and what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is not forgive and forget. There's an African proverb that says the axe forgets and the tree remembers. It's not possible to forget. Here's the cool thing. You don't have to forget to forgive.
Yeah.
But here's the other cool thing is that when you allow the Lord to come in and you're able to forgive, no more is that place hurting. You can have the memory without the pain. Forgiveness is not trusting the one who hurts you. It's trusting Jesus.
Amen.
Scripture does not mandate you to trust in a person, ever. But it does mandate you to trust in God. Forgiveness is not saying that the offender is not responsible. It's not minimizing the wrong. It's not looking the other way. It's not pretending it didn't happen and that evil's not really evil. Okay? That's not Jesus at all. He would look at evil and he would call it out. He would say, this is evil. This is wrong. Forgiveness is not merely politeness, tact, or diplomacy, or the refusal to acknowledge wrong. That's not forgiveness at all. But forgiveness is exercising your faith. Forgiveness is choosing to recognize, believing God at the very core basis, that the lie that comes in when we've been perpetrated on and we've been hurt that says, if you don't hold them accountable, nobody will. So we have to make sure to keep that fresh. We need to make sure to keep that alive because I have to make sure that he has his consequences or she has his consequences. Forgiveness is willing to take God for all he's worth and say, you know what, Lord? I'm going to let you deal with that person as you see fit. But I choose and I refuse to die. I refuse to die because of what was done to me.
Amen.
I choose life. So forgiveness is exercising your faith. It is rare, it is difficult, and it is costly. But I'm telling you, it will cost you something. It will cost you your validation. It will cost you your justification. It will cost you your vindication. It will cost you all of that. Forgiveness is recognizing that no one ever really forgives another except he bears the penalty of that person's sin against himself. In other words, you may have physical scars. You may have emotional, mental wounds that have happened. Jeremy shared the story with the sniper. The sniper's the one that shot him. Who's responsible to heal? We're responsible to heal. We have to recognize this is what happened. This is the state I'm in at the moment. Okay, Jesus, you and me. Let's get healed. Let's get free. Let's forgive. Forgiveness is surrendering your pain to Jesus to be healed. And ultimately, you guys, it's actually taking away the power that the enemy has from the offender to continue to cause you pain. As long as it can be fresh in your mind, as long as we can recall it, as long as we're living in this state of who can I build up next, it will continue to cause you pain. But when you choose to forgive, and God's way of forgiving, it actually takes that power away from the enemy, and you're no longer having to be stuck and live in pain. I had a woman ask me, is it even possible to not just feel pain all the time? Yes.
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Matthew 18:34, you guys know the story of the servant who owed some money, a small amount of money. And the fellow servant who owed a massive amount of money to the king. And the king forgave him these billions of dollars. And he went over to his fellow servant who owed him, it's like 20 bucks in comparison, and had him thrown in jail along with his family and everything else so he could repay everything he owed. Jesus wasn't sharing this story just for fun, to be like, be nice to your fellow servants while you're in slavery. He was saying, no, this is what happens. We all can come from a place of starting in slavery. And look what we've been forgiven of.
Amen.
And what we are extending and offering to those around us. It says in Matthew 18:34, the master who had forgiven the servant of so much was angry when he discovered that he refused to forgive his fellow servant of so little. And he delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. Do you guys know who the torturers were? It's not the little men with little whips. It was actually the demonic. He gave him over and said, you know what? You're refusing to let me come in. You're refusing to let me heal your heart. You're refusing to accept my forgiveness. You're refusing to extend it. You can only extend what you've been given. So the enemy's going to have a heyday with you. Forgiveness is agreeing with God about him, about yourself. God was not the perpetrator of the pain. Don't blame him. Recognize and repent of any of the anger that we have held on towards God. Here's what happens so often when we've been hurt relationally this way. We automatically get our little frame of, well, I know who God is then. This is who he is. And we start correlating God this way. As if he was the perpetrator. As if he was the one that hurt us. So the first step of believing, you don't you love it how all these tie together? The first step of believing to be able to forgive is recognizing, God, that was not you. That was not your plan. You're not the one that perpetrated against me. And I am sorry for having held you in this box, of holding you in this frame,
right,
equalizing you to, right, all those who have hurt me. I'm sorry.
Amen.
And don't allow the enemy to accuse you and weigh you down with shame any longer. Forgive yourself. Here's the thing. We cannot extend true forgiveness if we refuse to accept it from God. This isn't saying, This is about, Lord, what he offered this man that you guys saw. The extension of God's forgiveness that he offered to them, if we have to receive that. Forgiveness isn't optional. It's not if I feel like it. It's not maybe tomorrow. I'll think about that later. I'm not sure I'm ready for that yet. You don't know what was done to me. Forgiveness is not optional. Matthew 6:15 says, if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. It's not optional. Forgiveness is not just a good idea. It holds life and freedom. I don't know if you guys have watched little kids as they're learning new skills with things, whether they're learning to tie their shoes, or they're learning how to make their beds, or whatever they're doing, but learning new skills. And in the process of learning something new, we mess up sometimes. It's hard. Or we're concentrating really, really hard, and it's like, how many of you guys have heard little kids be like, I can't do it?
All the time. All the time.
Now, is it true that they can't do it?
No.
No. It's that it's really, really hard. And sometimes when we're concentrating so hard, it feels like my brain might explode and I just can't do it. We cannot say that we can't forgive because we don't want to or because it's hard. I love getting to share this tool because this is something, this was a very pivotal point in my life, and God taught me how to be able to break into true freedom. Not just stay in this place of, I'm good. Oh, what? No, that, okay, I just won't look at that. I'm good. No, I don't look at that either. See, I came from a family that loved the Lord. But they were hurting. Both my parents were first-generation Christians. By far the hardest, most amazing, most rewarding job for all of you first-generation Christians. I commend you. Because the blessings that you are now producing will go on to 1,000 generations.
Come on.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo. So my mom and dad were both first-generation Christians. Love the Lord, but traumatized. My mom had all of the ACEs except for one. Her perpetrator was never thrown in jail. It was her dad. He was her biggest abuser. She was born out of wedlock, wasn't wanted, starved, beaten, abused sexually, physically, you name it. Uprooted from Germany, moved to America when she was 3 and became the one that was responsible for making sure that her family could meld with the American world while abuse was continuing on. Remember we mentioned with Caroline Leaf, 85 to 98% of all physical, mental, spiritual issues, health issues, are related to our thought life. So here I have my mom, who adores the Lord, who loves the Lord, and my dad, who loves the Lord, but are hurting. We didn't know anything about, there's healing from the past. We don't just get up and move forward. Don't we just get up and move forward? Isn't it about how we finish the race? Not, we don't want to go back. So I have these parents who are committed to the Lord, and they love each other, but they're broken. And by the time I was 3, my mom was diagnosed with MS. By the time I was 9, she was in a wheelchair, unable to use most of her body. She could kind of use one hand. And my dad is watching his wife, who he knew her whole backstory, and watching her get sicker and sicker, and he's getting angrier at God, going, what? Has she not been through enough? And here my mom is trying to figure out, if I can just survive, I lived through that hell, I can do it through this one too. So they're just trying to make it. Let me tell you what, they didn't just make it, they broke off more generational curses off of our family. They're champions.
Yes.
My mom battled cancer 6 times on top of MS.
Wow.
And it was because of the fact that she refused to let go of Jesus that she outlived the doctors by 20 years. All I knew was my dad was angry and my mom was like bipolar. She would flip on a dime and 1 minute she's fine, the next minute you better duck. And things were just upside down. But we were the church family. Every time church was open, we were there. And I went to a Christian school. This is how life is supposed to be. And I remember as I went away to college, I remember setting the intention. I was so intentional. I will not repeat that. I will not be angry like my dad. I will not be manipulative and overcritical and emotionally abusive like my mom. I will not. But without the Holy Spirit empowering, overtaking you, here's the thing. With intention, you're still hanging on. I have intention. I will not repeat those behaviors. I will not be like that. I'm going to, who's still in control? Me. So I met my amazing husband at college. We get married. And what comes out of me? The very thing I said I wasn't going to do. But I was in control. Not. As I'm losing it in rage, I wasn't in control. I was completely out of control. We were married 10 months later, 11 months later we had our daughter. A few months later we found out we were pregnant again. Pretty soon I'm holding my baby son and I'm looking at him and I'm crying out, Lord, Lord, I can't pass this on. I can't give to them what I said I would never do. So I went on an intensive journey with the Lord. Heal me, Jesus. And he took me immediately to forgiveness. You have to forgive. And I went, yeah, but Lord, it's forgiven. It's all good. It's forgiven. I forgive them. You can just see his look going, how's that working for you? Forgive. Give it to me because I can take this and I can make it beautiful And in the process of what my spirit does in you, the forgiveness will be a fruit. You just keep choosing to give to me. You keep choosing to let my hands be in the middle of it. So I started asking him, Lord, I need your heart and I need your eyes. Because everything that was done was through my small perspective, my frame, my glasses of pain. And I couldn't change that out by myself. But I refused to keep him on any longer. So Jesus came in and started reframing my pain. Started reframing. And what happened was, it wasn't looking at what had happened for longer and longer and longer. It was looking at what happened and then locking my eyes with Jesus. Because when I kept my eyes locked with Jesus, I knew then how he felt about me. I knew how he felt about my situation. I knew how he felt about my heart. I knew how he felt about how hard he was going to work on behalf of me and what his love for me and his passion for me. So I locked my eyes with Jesus. And sometimes you guys have ever been in the situation where you're in the middle of something and you're just like, have I even moved? And then something happens and you see yourself responding and you're like, did you see that? That wasn't me before. I started having these things occur. I got a call from my mom at one point. There was a family feud happening. Her stepdad, her biological mom had died. The stuff that she had left to her from heirlooms from Germany, from her family, her stepdad had taken and burned, or gave to his biological daughter. And everyone was up in arms. Everything was in an uproar. And I get a call. You're not going to believe it. And my heart broke. I remember telling my mom, Mom, can you imagine the stuff he went through to make him so bitter and angry and hateful? I'd like to say my mom's response was, oh, you're so right. No, she hung up on me. And at first I was thinking, did that just come out of my mouth? What have I done? And then I thought, oh, Jesus, you're transforming me. You're giving me a new frame. You're giving me new glasses. You're letting me see through your eyes. You're giving me your heart. I get a call back from my mom probably a couple hours later that day. And I can hear her seething on the other line. She's mad. But she says, how can you see it like that? And I had every opportunity to say, because Mom, when I was little, you did this and this and this and this and this. And I was really, really bitter. And I was really mad. And I started behaving just like you, even though I said I never would. And I could have gone on and on and on. That wasn't from Holy Spirit empowerment. I got to say, Mom, let me tell you what God's doing in me. This is what he's been revealing light in me. And this is how he's changing me. And this is how I'm getting freedom. I'll tell you what. They had the opportunity. The enemy had an opportunity to come in and to turn my mom off towards me. Because I'll tell you what, when the Holy Spirit is evident, it can be convicting. But my mom loves the Lord. And this is what happened. I start getting calls. It was weekly. And pretty soon it was a couple times a week, and then pretty soon it was almost every day. This is happening. What are your thoughts? Oh, this is what's going on here. What do you think? This is happening. Can you pray with me? Oh, this is going on. This is what's happening with your dad. Can you tell me a new way to love your dad so he's not so angry? I'll never forget that conversation. You guys, I could have missed every opportunity if I would have chosen to refuse to forgive the hurt that had happened. Now, we don't always get to see the fruit of our forgiveness. But we get to experience the freedom that it brings.
Yes,
please. As time started seeing my mom was getting new glasses and a new frame of God as well. Pretty soon I'm watching things shift a little bit for my dad, and he's starting to get a new frame and new glasses. And I'm like, oh Jesus, you're amazing.
Generational blessings.
Passed on. But here's the thing, is that my mom, her dad, February 18th of 2009, died. Curse of God to the day he died. My mom never got to see the fruit of that with her dad. But before he died, we all went to his memorial, and she got to go there having forgiven her dad.
Yes.
He didn't die free, but he went with her being free. January 28th of 2010, almost exactly a year later, my mom was finally freed. Ultimately. From all the physical encumbrances that held her back. But I'll tell you what happened in the process. As I was walking this, and as I was discovering what this new freedom looked like and felt like, and it's like a whole new world. Okay?
Yeah.
It is a whole new world. It's all new discovery. And as I was walking this and discovering this, I was getting to share with mom, as she would call. I'd be like, guess what God showed me today? And I would share with her, and I'm starting to watch her walk in this freedom. It was unbelievable. She was more free the day that she died than she was all the years previous. Dedicated his life to my mom. He was her sole caregiver. She was his identity. So when she went to be with Jesus, the very thing that should have crushed him to dust blossomed him into something beautiful. And to this day, I'm watching my dad still walk. Every day a little more free. Every day a little more free. Because God's promises and his word never returns void. You guys, you may or may not see the fruit of forgiveness in others, but you will live the fruit. Confession brings the healing. Forgiveness brings the fruit.
Thank you.
It'll clear the bitterness away. It can even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can't do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness.
Receive this way.